to suppose. dressed himself and prepared for a luxurious night's rest. Here, contrary to the custom of this species of tale, we leave the general in possession of his apartment until the next morning. The company assembled for breakfast at an early hour, but without the appearance of General Brown, who seemed the guest desirous of honouring above all this guest entirely apart from the rest of the company. When turning round upon him with an air of great solemnity, he addressed him thus: "Richard Brown, my old and very dear friend, we are now alone. Let me conjure you to answer me upon the word of a friend and the honour of a soldier. How did you in reality rest during last night?" "Most wretchedly indeed, my lord," answered the general, in the same tone of solemnity, "so miserably that I would not run the risk of such a second night, not only for all the lands belonging to this castle, but for all the country which I see from this elevated point of view." "That is most extraordinary," said the young lord, as if speaking to himself. "Then there must be some concerning that apartment." Again turning to the general, he said, "For God's sake, my dear friend, be candid with me, and let me know the disagreeable particulars which have befallen you under a roof where, with consent of the owner, you should have met nothing save comfort." The general seemed distressed by this appeal, perceiving that Lord Woodville remained silent possession of the premises. She turned slowly round, but, gracious heaven, my lord, what a countenance did she display to me! There was no longer any question what she was, or any thought of her being a living being. Upon a face which wore the fixed features of a corpse were imprinted the traces of the vilest and most hideous passions which had animated her while she lived. The body of some atrocious criminal seemed to have been given up from the grave, and the soul restored from the penal fire, in order to form for a space a union with the ancient accomplice of its guilt. I started up in bed, and sat upright, supporting myself on my palms, as I gazed on this horrible spectre. The hag made, as it seemed, a single and swift stride to the bed where I lay, and squatted herself down upon it in precisely the same attitude which I had assumed in the extremity of horror, advancing her diabolical countenance within half a yard of mine, with a grin which seemed to intimate the malice and the derision of an incarnate fiend. Here, General Brown stopped, and wiped from his brow the cold perspiration with which the recollection of his horrible vision had covered it. "My lord," he said, "I am no coward. I have been in all the mortal dangers incidental to my profession, and I may truly boast that no man ever knew Richard Brown dishonor the sword he wears. But in these horrible circumstances, under the eyes, and as it seemed almost in the grasp of an incarnation of an evil spirit, all firmness forsook me, all manhood melted from me like wax in the furnace, and I felt my hair individually bristle. The current of my lifeblood ceased to flow, and I sank back in a swoon, as very a victim to panic terror as ever there was a village girl or a child of 10 years old. How long I lay in this condition I cannot pretend to guess. But I was roused by the castle clock striking one, so loud that it seemed as if it were in the very room. It was some time before I dared open my eyes, lest they should again encounter the horrible spectacle. When, however, I summoned courage to look up, she was no longer visible. My first idea was to pull my bell, wake the servants, and remove to a garret or a hayloft, to be insured against a second visitation. Nay, I will confess the truth, that my resolution was altered, not by the shame of exposing myself, but by the fear that as the bell cord hung by the chimney, I might, in making my way to it, be again crossed by the fiendish hag, who I figured to myself might be still lurking about some corner of the apartment. I will not pretend to describe what hot and cold fever fits tormented me for the rest of the night, through broken sleep, weary vigils, and that dubious state which forms the neutral ground between them. 100 terrible objects appeared to haunt me, but there was the great difference betwixt the vision which I have described and those which followed, that I knew the last to be deceptions of my own fancy and overexcited nerves. Day at last appeared, and I rose from my bed ill in health and humiliated in mind. I was ashamed of myself as a man and a soldier, and still more so at feeling my own extreme desire to escape from the haunted apartment, which, however, conquered all other considerations. So that, huddling on my clothes with the most careless haste, I made my escape from your lordship's mansion, to seek in the open air some relief to my nervous system, shaken as it was by this horrible encounter with a visitant. For such places I trust we may often meet, but God protect me from ever spending a second night under that roof. Strange as the general's tale was, he spoke with such a deep air of conviction that it cut short all the usual commentaries which are made on such stories. Lord Woodville never once asked him if he was sure suggested any of the possibilities by which it is fashionable to explain supernatural appearances as wild vagaries of the fancy or deceptions of the optic nerves. On the contrary, he seemed deeply impressed with the truth and reality of what he had heard, and after a considerable pause, regretted with much appearance of sincerity that his early friend should have suffered so severely. I am the more sorry for your pain, my dear Brown, he continued, that it is the unhappy, though most unexpected, result of an experiment of my own. You must know that for my father and grandfather's time at least, the apartment which was assigned to you last night had been shut on account of reports that it was disturbed. Sights and noises. When I came a few weeks since into possession of the estate, I thought the accommodation which the castle afforded for my friends was not extensive enough to permit the inhabitants of the invisible world to retain possession of a comfortable sleeping apartment. I therefore caused the Tapestried Chamber, as we call it, to be opened, and without destroying its air of antiquity, I had such new articles of furniture placed in it as become the modern times. Yet, as the opinion that the room was haunted very strongly prevailed among the domestics, and was also known in the neighbourhood and to many of my friends, I feared some prejudice might be entertained by the first occupant of the Tapestried Chamber, which might tend to revive the evil report which it had laboured under, and so disappoint my purpose of rendering it a useful part of the house. I must confess, my dear Brown, that your arrival yesterday, agreeable to me for a thousand reasons besides, seemed the most favourable opportunity of removing the unpleasant rumours which attached to the room. Since your courage was indubitable, your mind free of any preoccupation on the subject, I could not, therefore, have chosen a more fitting subject for my experiment. Upon my life, said General Brown, somewhat hastily, I am infinitely obliged to your lordship, very particularly indebted indeed. I am likely to remember for some time the consequences of the experiment, as your lordship is pleased to call it. Now you are unjust, my dear friend, said Lord Woodville. You have only to reflect for a single moment in order to be convinced that I could not augur the possibility of the pain to which you have been so unhappily exposed. I was yesterday morning a complete sceptic on the subject of supernatural appearances. Nay, I am sure that had I told you what was said about that room, those very to select it for your accommodation. It was my misfortune, perhaps my error, but really cannot be termed my fault that you have been afflicted so strangely. Strangely indeed, said the general, resuming his good temper, and I acknowledge that I have no right to be offended with your lordship for treating me like what I used to think myself, a man of some firmness and courage. But I see my post horses have arrived, and I must not detain your lordship from your amusement. Nay, my old friend, said Lord Woodville, since you cannot stay with us another day, which indeed I can no longer urge, give me at least half an hour more. You used to love pictures, and I have a gallery of portraits, some of them by Van Dyck, representing She is.